ERISA.
ERISA.
Okay. Or Medicare, Medicare Advantage. Yeah. And then State Health Medical, maybe Seminole. What was that?
Can I just think about whatever
George
bottom of the wall.
Thank you.
Can I get your attention, please? Welcome to the subcommittee of the Health and Human Services Committee. And before we begin, I'd like to ask Senator Setzler to open us in prayer. What's your mic?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, the giver of all good things, we just praise you and thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We pray, Lord, that we would be mindful of the least of these, Lord, that you've called us to serve and be mindful of. Pray that we would humble ourselves before you, pray that you'd give us the wisdom that only you can give. Bless these proceedings today, that we would ask hard questions, that we would understand truth when we hear it, and seek to glorify you in all we do. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Senator. So we have one bill on our agenda today, House Bill 520. It's for a hearing only. We're not voting on this bill today. The bill crossed over from the House just over a week ago, and time is short before the end of the session. We have committee members with multiple conflicts, and so we have a hard stop at 3 o'clock today. Because of that, we're gonna have the House sponsors present the bill, have questions from the committee, and then we'll take as much public testimony as we have time for. Because of the public interest on both sides of this bill, we're going to ask everyone to keep their comments to 2 minutes or less, and we'll notify you when you have 30 seconds remaining once you're recognized. If someone has already made your point, feel free to waive your time, and please identify yourself when you go to the podium, which is right over there. If you signed up and don't get to speak, you can submit written testimony, and we'd be happy to distribute that to the subcommittee. In the Senate, our rules require decorum and respect for each other, so we won't be able to have cheering, clapping, or shouting, and please don't block anybody else's line of sight. The hearing is being live streamed on the legislative website, and it's also visible on the TVs outside of the committee room. So with that, we're going to have the bill presented, starting with Representative Jones, Chairman Jones, and Representative Oliver.
Result number one.
Witness
one?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay,
the floor is yours.
Can you hear me? Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. I sure do appreciate it. Bring it closer. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I appreciate that, and I appreciate the opportunity, as does Representative Oliver, to present House Bill 520 to you today. I am going to, for the purposes of the committee, I'm going to cover sections 3, 6, 10, 11, 14, 15, 16, 17, and the latter part of 19. Representative Oliver will come around on the remaining 20, or not the remaining 20, but of the 20, she'll do the remainder, and then also the first part of 19. We wanted to start with these because these were the ones that, frankly, that we understand that you were hearing the most amount of questions about, and we felt as if we should hit those head on, as opposed to just going through it in a numerical order. We felt as if that would be helpful for the committee to basically understand exactly what the process was in terms of how we got here. Representative Oliver will go through a series of different, I'll say, ways that the information was put together, but ultimately, please know this, the Behavioral Health Commission, along with all of its subcommittee chairs, were absolutely critical and integral in terms of the development of House Bill 520. Moving on to Section 3 of House Bill 520, one of the things that you will see inside of this bill is of the 20 sections, five of them are literally studies in terms of five out of the 20, and Section 3 fills that slot very, very well. This was one that came out of Chief Justice Boggs' subcommittee, and it really focuses on serious mental illness and then also on familiar faces. The focus here is to be able to put together all of the stakeholders who are involved in this very critical group of people. Whether or not you own a business or whether or not you're just managing a family, the fact is you look for that one small piece of data or that one small group that is taking up a significant amount of your resources, and that is effectively your familiar faces. These are individuals that are known in the homeless community, they are known within the healthcare community, and they're also known within, unfortunately, the law enforcement, the incarceration, maybe the sheriff or maybe the DOC. It's absolutely imperative, since these individuals make up probably 1% of all the mental health patients we have in this state or less, that we get a hold of this, basically this crazy cycle they're on. And if you can think of a three-legged stool, they're going from homelessness to healthcare into incarceration, and they just keep going. They may make up 1% or less than 1% of our mental health community, but they take up an exorbitant amount of the resources. Hence, we've asked all the stakeholders, and you see that in Section 3, to get together and really finalize what do we see as a proper definition, and then how it is would be some of the ways that we could address that. Again, recommendations. Moving on to Section 6, this is another one of the five study sections. This is a bed study. We've been asked several times, why do we need a bed study? This is not just about counting beds. This is about understanding not just the number of beds inside of the state of Georgia, but also the types of beds. Are they inpatient? Are they outpatient? Are they acute? Are they extended care, etc.? And then equally important, you will see in there that we also need to know, are they in-state or out-of-state residents currently occupying those beds? One of the things that we find from this type of information is that we know that our reimbursement rates are so low compared to our neighboring states when it comes to Medicaid reimbursement that a lot of these for-profit entities are actually incented to take out-of-state cash-paying customers as opposed to a Georgia citizen. Sections 10 and 11 are effectively mirrors of each other, one regarding mental health and one regarding substance abuse. Effectively, one of the things that you all have been hearing about are, quote, the two affidavits. And the two affidavits declaring whether or not someone may have mental illness or whether or not they may have substance abuse issues. Let me be perfectly clear, that is existing law that has literally been there for decades. That is not new law. We are not treading new ground. That is something that has been there. People ask all the time, why not just a physician's order? Well, unfortunately, here in the state of Georgia, not proud of this stat, but we have counties without doctors. I'll say that one more time. We have counties without doctors. The second type of person who's going to be helped by this is that individual, like the 17-year-old who came up to me at a town hall and said, my mom has the ability to, quote, stay straight when the police are there, and then she immediately devolves as soon as the police leave. Imagine that. We're expecting the police to witness it. They can't witness it, so they can't effectively start the process, but yet this 17-year-old has become effectively the adult of the house. So this is not an avenue that is taken often in current law. Typically, it is the physician's order that is taken. However, our feeling is that not only is that existing law, but what we wanted to do was attach the physician's order or the two affidavits to the judge's order. So keep in mind, the two affidavits go in front of a judge. That order then goes with the patient to the hospital. We, at that point, and you'll see in the new language, we ask that the affiant's names be redacted there. That is strictly from a public safety and from a public safety point of view. We do not want an individual who may be violent or who may be wanting to get some type of revenge after being put into that space to come after those individuals. Let me be clear. Those affidavits, along with the names and all the information on those affidavits, are part of the court record. They can be obviously opened up by the court. They can be opened up by proper, you know, lawyering in terms of getting that information. This is not information that suddenly is redacted forever, but rather it remains. Moving on to Section 14 and 15. Surprised that the pushback on 14 and 15, because this is essentially the exact same language of 43-35-5.1. I'll say that reference one more time. 43-35-5.1 that went in 2010. Including the entity language around immunity. In 2010, we put it in for the doctors. In 2023, what we're asking for is to put this in for mental health professionals and nurses. Effectively, from a workforce development standpoint, and I'll just use, and this is just an example, a 35-year-old nurse gets addicted to OxyContin. We would like that nurse to somehow stay in the workforce once they get rehab, not lose their license forever. This allows them to be able to go to the licensing board and basically admit that they are addicted. They probably get their license, if they do get their license, suspended, and then they go through rehab and they go through testing, et cetera, 90 days, 120 days, whatever is prescribed by the doctor, and then ultimately the entity will prescribe back to the licensing board a recommendation of whether or not they should get their license back or not. Let me be clear. 2 years from now, if that nurse does something wrong, or that nurse does, you know, in terms of at least an assumption of malpractice, all the information is absolutely discoverable inside of any type of court proceeding. Section 16 is another one that is regarding data sharing. I think it's imperative that we all understand that effectively Our governor sits within the Constitution to be one of the most powerful governors within the entire United States from a constitutional standpoint. That's not an opinion of Mr. Kemp, but rather just what the Constitution gives in terms of authority and responsibility to the governor. Over the years, that responsibility has been split up into a myriad of different agencies. We all can basically say the alphabet soup names. What you'll see is there are databases within each one of those entities, but ultimately, there's an executive branch file cabinet, for lack of a better phrase, and there are folders within that file cabinet that represent each one of the agencies. What we want to be able to do is have those agencies share the data. I'll say that one more time. Share the data, but under federal law, state law, and then also the suspension, not the suspension, but basically taking out PII, making sure that it's limited, making sure that's encrypted at rest, encrypted during transit, etc. So this by no means strikes any responsibility when it comes to the privacy, when it comes to cyber best practices, but rather it allows for us to have a function, and you will see in there that a director is appointed for the GDAC, and ultimately that individual will be the one that will determine if that data can be shared, and if it can be shared, it must go underneath all current federal and state laws. There's an appeals process in there to the Executive Council of the governor, but ultimately what we're trying to do here is this, everyone. We want to basically determine, is there a way to help? Can we help with the data that we have? We see businesses every day look at data and determine, is there a trend line that would be able to help the citizens of Georgia, and how can we be proactive? Section 17, and I'm almost done, I got section 17, the latter part of 19. Section 17, there's been a significant amount of, I'll say, conjecture regarding Medicaid and what that is doing. I want to be clear, there is no expansion of the roles of Medicaid in any of those subsections. One more time. There's no expansion of the roles of Medicaid in any of those subsections. What it does, though, is you will see Section A, for instance, those individuals that would get those three existing diagnostic codes, they are already qualified for Medicaid and getting a series of services from Medicaid. However, those three diagnostic codes, we believe, will save the state a significant amount of money because they're diagnostic codes. If we have a better understanding of what that individual's challenge is, we can come up with a better treatment plan, and hopefully that individual is able to get better or at least get stabilized in a shorter amount of time, hence reducing the amount of resources that the state has to pay for that. You will then see further down in D, E, and F, I believe, or C, D, and E, you will see that is effectively moving that into the state plan. Right now it's in CMS, and then moving that into the state plan. That effectively calls for the state already doing most of that work to effectively do that work. But to be clear, it does not expand the roles. And then finally, section 19, I'll take the second half of that, and I'll allow Representative Oliver to take the first half. The second half of that speaks to the repayment of loans. Let me be perfectly clear, we have a problem. I don't say that tongue in cheek, I don't say that as some type of, you know, political comment, but we literally have, just like we have counties without doctors, we have counties and communities without mental health professionals. We have counties and communities without substance abuse professionals. So how do we find a way to get these individuals into Lanier County, into Ware County, into Eccles County? I can keep going. But I think it's imperative that we are able to say to ourselves, how can we do that? And I think it's important that we look at that in such a way that how can we as a state use our resources appropriately? This is not the paying off of student loans. If someone went to NYU and took on $250,000 of student loans, I would say to them, I don't think that was a good decision, but that's my own personal opinion, but this does not relieve them of that. Rather, it's $10,000 a year for up to 5 years if they remain in that underserved community. And to that point, to line 1021, I do believe that we either need to narrowly define underserved youth or we need to redact that completely. But after having more and more time with that, I don't believe that underserved youth, I think it's too broad, and I think we either need to take it out or we need to define it better. But the next line around underserved areas, I think, is well defined, and I wanted to make sure you know that. Finally, there was a colleague of mine who came to me on Thursday of last week, who I thought made a very good recommendation for the latter part of 19, and that's what I'm gonna call the public good clause. And effectively what he said was, what we can do is help communities to better see, I'll say, the effects of mental health and substance abuse, and what could these individuals that the state has said, you know what, you're so important, we need you down there, is there a way through some type of best practice within their loan document, not to do anything other than say, given best practices, commercial best practices, what type of information could you provide to the community to help them understand what would be the, I'll say, first indicators or second indicators of mental health or substance abuse? Madam Chairwoman, that is the end of my comments.
Thank you, and I know you're going to have to leave, but we're going to go ahead. Representative Oliver, if you could cover the other sections, and then if you're willing to take all the questions, that'd be great.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm very happy to be here, and I appreciate the privilege of presenting another opportunity for the state to move forward on mental health reform. What is different this year than was presented to you in 1013? I'd like to take just a moment to talk about that. In 1013, we came to the General Assembly with a number of different recommendations that came from the Behavioral Health and Innovation Commission, chaired by Kevin Tanner. And we put into 1013 a number of different work efforts that have resulted in specific, because they were tasks defined, because there was a date and there was an accountability to respond to the tasks set forth in legislation, we have new products about which we can move forward. For instance, the prescription formulary had been signed to many different agencies, but had never been accomplished. 1013 said one agency, Governor's Health Innovation Strategy Commission, shall do it. They did it in a timely manner. We had a transportation study accomplished, which allows Kevin Tanner now to move forward with a pilot project on the transportation of mentally ill patients, which is a controversy within our sheriff's and law enforcement department. I just give those two examples to show that setting out a work plan, making an entity accountable, and getting a result allows you to take the next step of good management. And good management is using the taxpayers' money effectively in a focused way. What's different in 2022 and 2023 and 520 is that in addition to the committee, subcommittee process that was set up by the Behavioral Health Commission, we have had significant contributions from the executive agencies this year that we did not have last year. The subcommittees, as you may remember, are chaired by Justice Boggs, or Judge in relation to criminal justice issues, chaired by Judge Amaro in relation to involuntary commitment, chaired by Dr. Brenda Fitzgerald in relation to child and adolescent behavioral health, and I had the privilege of chairing the workforce subcommittee. Each of our subcommittees met on a monthly basis. We have a several hundred page report. All of our committees are recorded and you can watch them at any length you like. Differently this year, Grant Thomason, the Health Strategy and Coordination Commission, has been a major contributor in the issue of data collection and data sharing. Obviously, Kevin Tanner, in his new role, important new role, as Commissioner of Behavioral Health and Developmental Disability, he is now more actively engaged in this bill in relation to bolstering some of the tasks that are necessary in the forensic population within his agency. There's 641 forensic beds. It's the only real psychiatric hospital the state manages. He's also been active in asking for work in the bed study and asking for work in the staffing analysis. Justice Boggs has become, as you know, a national leader in relation to criminal justice reform, and that has turned into a deeper dive into the behavioral health folks that are incarcerated in the 143 jails that we have across Georgia. Justice Boggs, because he's a leader, has been able to attract national grant money and national attention, and a number of different sections of this bill come from him. A number of sections come from Grant Thomas, and a number of other sections come from Commissioner Tanner. And I'm pleased to talk about them briefly, as to the extent the chair would like me to talk about the other parts of the bill, but also answer questions. We know, and I don't need to tell you this, that workforce is the biggest challenge facing all the social service agencies and all of the state of Georgia, and not as well as the private businesses across our state. As chair of the Workforce Study Committee, we have focused on not only the loan forgiveness and the alternative disciplinary process that's been successful for doctors and 10 other health professionals for about a decade. The licensing board issues gained a lot of attention in our subcommittee discussions. And we looked at the way other states are modernizing the procedures by going on in line with different kind of programs. The era of filling out a form in pencil and mailing it in with a check just doesn't exist anymore. And the licensing board analysis, we had probably 25 to 40 different specific suggestions for modernization, and we turned that into giving again to the governor's executive commission, the strategy and coordination commission, the task of giving to us a report within 6 months of all of these 25 different recommendations. We know that the use of foreign trained professionals is extensively a strong aspect of the way we're recruiting staff. 10% of Georgians are born in another country, speak another language, and other states around us have set up specialized, more modern ways to move foreign-trained professionals into our healthcare system using what I think of as the HN1 farm program. Is being used by some of our private hospitals in order to bring the daily service providers in to deal with patients. In relation to the, I met this morning, I met several times, but I met again this morning with Kaylee Noggle on the complications of the issues that are set forth in Section 17. What is a doable without legislation, the state plan? What is doable in a waiver? And what is doable in the procurement contracts? There's a lot of moving parts to all that, but what we do know is that our children in Georgia who have mental health crisis are not being served adequately. 40% of our state's 600 beds, intensive psychiatric beds in Georgia, are filled by out-of-state children. Our reimbursement rates are inadequate to manage this kind of gift we are providing to other states around us and not providing to the children in Georgia. In 1013, we did a deep data analysis about where a certain number of our health professionals are working, and for us to give a better understanding of how we would distribute monies on the loan forgiveness plan. And the second part of Section 19 that Representative Jones referred to expands that list of medical professionals who we need more information. Where do they practice? Do they have a license but retired now? Where are they willing to take additional responsibilities or benefits that they might be able to extend? These are the kinds of questions that the real data analysis has to bring forward for us to make the next step. I want to say that Commissioner Christopher Nunn also has participated in this bill. He wanted the task we're giving him. There are many different streams of funding, all of which are federal and private, substantially all of which. There's about $1 million that goes for homeless from state money, but it's essentially federal money. The different streams and the different use of COVID money and ARPA money is all given us an opportunity. Christopher Nunn wants us to give him this obligation, again, for accountability and a day to look at the funding streams for homeless and figure out how does this homeless population, again, create greater stress on our businesses as they live invisibly in our community and greater stress on our jail population? Madam Chair, that might be a good spot to pause, and I'm happy to answer questions or proceed any way you would like.
Well, I will kick us off with one question, and that is, did you guys happen to get a fiscal note on the House side?
I have been soliciting fiscal note. I did not formally ask for, I know that you had formally asked for a fiscal note, and I went over those data with Commissioner Nagel this morning, and they probably the same data she's giving you. And we have asked House Appropriations to prepare for us a sheet as our appropriations process goes forward. What are we funded on 520? What have we not funded yet? What's left on the table? We did that last year with 1013. Chair may remember we had a document that showed how each section, and we're preparing that document. I don't have it finalized for you today.
Questions from the committee? You have one question?
What's your microphone? If you grab the way, I can ask him later. I did it some later. Okay. Chairman Oliver, thank you for being here. Couple questions, and we can take some of these offline if we need to. I just wanted to understand some of the operative things that are important in this. One thing that comes up in Section 3 of the bill, the definition of serious mental illness,
What exactly, that a lot hinges on that definition in this bill and as it sort of works outside and doing its work. What hinges on that definition? What kinds of decisions?
We're focusing on, the population that goes from jail to street to ER, from jail to street to ER. And this comes from Justice Boggs' work. The 143 jails don't have a definition for severe mental illness. And if you are going, as he is doing, Chief Justice Boggs, to look at grant funding and federal streams, you got to define what is a serious mental illness. And is it the same for the jail that's got, like, City of Decatur's jail at Closet versus DeKalb?
Well, really what I had in mind was what hinges on that? I mean, as you talk about, you know, involuntary civil committal and those kinds of things, there's certain elements you have to demonstrate to be able to say, yes, this threshold's been met, there's a certain set of conditions. Is a serious mental illness a necessary element of an involuntary committal?
Well, serious mental illness in the bill is different than is different from the legal standard by which a 1013 or a guardianship is created. And I'll address either one. They're not the same. Serious mental illness is essentially a medical diagnosis of a severe psychiatric illness. And there are definitions out there that say schizophrenia, less than 1% of our population, is a serious mental illness. But there's no comprehensive definition. The capacity issue for a 1013 or a guardianship is different, if you'd like me to discuss that. And it's not addressed in this bill.
So serious mental illness would maybe be a higher threshold than a committal, I think, right?
No, I wouldn't say that. I would say for me, it's really a medical diagnosis.
Would that be an element in a finding of incompetence to stand trial?
No. And the forensic aspects of this bill are very intentional because we have a set of statute of in the weeds statutes about someone being declared mentally ill and then being restored to capacity. In the issue of criminal setting, I think it deals mainly with the capacity to understand the criminal trial you're in. Do I know what I'm being charged with? Do I have the ability to participate in my own defense? That's significantly different than the capacity issue in a guardianship, and significantly different from the medical diagnosis of schizophrenia or other severe mental illness.
And Madam Chair, I raised the question because the delegation that happens here and the agency is going to be they're going to get about their business quickly. They're going to define this by December of 23. Important things are going to hinge on that definition, and it seems to me that is the province of the General Assembly to determine those kinds of if legally significant things are going to hinge on a definition. You know, we're in the business when we do our good work, and I know you've seen good work here, you've seen bad work here.
I've seen them.
When we do our good work, we write definitions that because so much hinges on. I'm concerned a delegation that's going to have this much impact legally, and there's other settings we don't have time to talk through. That's a concern.
I think you're raising an interesting issue that I have not thought about in terms of the definition of severe mental illness in your perception, or perhaps serious mental illness, and perhaps impacting the issue of capacity to stand trial or the issue of granting of a guardianship for 1013. And I'm happy to take those questions back to the folks that work most in forensic and give you some more time and examples and understanding of that if it'd be helpful to you or the committee.
Yes, Representative, one of the things that has come up throughout the bill is referring to definitions that haven't been developed yet, and we're pretty protective in the General Assembly about defining things and certainly happy to look at proposals from agencies for definitions, but I suspect that may be one thing we'll be working on is being sure that we retain control of that process. We do have definitions of mental illness and substance abuse in the law, so this would be something different. I think at that point, we're going to stop and go ahead and take some public testimony because I know there are a lot of people who drove a long way to get down here, and we'd like to hear from as many people as we can. And this is not the last opportunity for people to weigh in, and certainly we will take written testimony, as I mentioned at the very beginning. Let me just remind you, we're going to limit individuals to 2 minutes just because we've got a long list of people signed up and we may not get to everybody today. And we'll get started with, we're going to start with Rhonda Thomas. And when you step up to the mic, if you just identify yourself and if you represent yourself or someone else. Thank you. We'll let you know when your time's getting close.
Rhonda Thomas, I'm representing myself. So I have questions about conflict of interest within the bill. Public-private partnerships have historically been financial gain for the lead agency, the nonprofits, and perhaps the executive committees to the detriment of the stakeholders. These have been employed by various HHS and Georgia State Health agencies since the 70s. They are controlled by those who give grants and private foundations and who give money or corporate sponsors. They eliminate accountability with the general public. There's also a conflict of interest when it comes to a lot of the organizations involved because they're backed by psychopharma. These are just a few, but not all of them. American Foundation of Suicide Prevention, Anxiety Disorders, Attention Deficit Disorder, Center of the Advancement of Children's Mental Health, Children and Adults with ADD, the list goes on and on. There's another, public-private partnerships have a tendency to grossly disproportionately benefit the lead host agency. We've talked about that. Health benefit plans shall not impose, on line 76, health benefit plans shall not impose a step therapy protocol for a prescription drug prescribed for the treatment of serious mental illness as defined by the department. Which prescription drugs? There is a sound reason to not automatically prescribe pharmaceuticals rather than using other therapeutic modalities. Sorry, I'm nervous. This needs to be more specific if it's kept at all. Line 157 to 159, validated screenings and best practices. The pharmaceutical corps have spent large amounts of researching, money on researching the development of subtle psychological screening tools, which will result in health behavioral health diagnosis. These are usually created by pharmaceutical for physicians that are not qualified to read or certified, such as psychologists and psychiatrists. And 78 to 80%
of the time, they lead to a diagnosis that requires pharmaceutical and mental illness. Is that my 2 minutes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
What's going on with mine?
That would have been interesting.
Okay, Kim Jones?
Thank you, Chairman and committee. My name is Kim Jones. I'm a member of the executive director of NAMI Georgia. I'm also a co-founder of the Georgia Mental Health Policy Partnership, and I sit on the Behavior Health Reform and Innovation Commission at the request of the late Speaker Ralston. And most importantly, I'm the mother of a son with a child with mental health conditions. A lot of work went into House Bill 520, and we welcome your...
Can you just hold up for a minute?
Sure.
Y'all, those with signs, please don't block other people's view. Thank you very much.
Yeah. We welcome the input from this committee to better the bill and to improve it. We always like to have good discussion on any bill that comes forth, especially one of this nature. But there were 24 experts from across the state that worked on this bill prior to it coming here, including Commissioner Kevin Tanner, CSB CEO Cindy Levi, doctors such as Dr. Brenda Fitzgerald and Dr. Lukowitz, judges across the state, including Justice Boggs, and 60 members of advocacy groups that meet every Friday, giving input to the testimony that was heard. I would like to ask the members of the Georgia Mental Health Policy Partnership and those in support to stand so you can see who all is here in support of this bill. It is important that you know that there are so many of us that work together on it. Thank you. Also, I ask that you do what is right for the people of Georgia to fix in the Behavioral Health Reform and Innovation Commission's work and to improve the system. I thank you in advance for your favorable consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Jones. Okay, Hank Sullivan.
First of all, thank you for the opportunity. Second of all,
came all the way down here from coming for 120 seconds of airtime, which I think is really unfair. I'd like for everyone who is against this bill to please stand up. The most egregious part of this bill that I find is the fact that the lead sponsor for the bill owns a company who stands to benefit from its passing. That is because he owns a monitoring company that does monitoring that is described in the bill. He had the same monitoring described in 1013 last year, and thankfully, for the hard work of the Senate, that monitoring aspect was removed. But he stands to gain from this. He and his partners stand to gain from this bill passing, and he's putting funding and he's putting grants in order to fund these different aspects of health.
Madam Chair, I wonder if that would be appropriate for his testimony to be when Chairman Jones is here. Sounds a little bit unfair.
No. Chairman Jones had the opportunity to be here.
Do you have line numbers in the bill that you're referring to?
Then he should have stayed.
Start his time again.
Yes.
You can
look at line numbers 551 through 558, 545 through 550. You're going to find that these line numbers deal with professional health care program, defining the professional health care program, and the fact that monitoring and rehabilitation of impaired health care professionals for the purpose of this, that, and the other thing. Impaired means the inability of a health care professional to practice and reasonable skill and safety to patients by reason of illness or use of alcohol, drugs, narcotics, and chemicals. What he's done is he's defined what his product does, which is a monitoring device. It monitors biometrics as well as GPS. So he's defined in the bill what his particular device actually does that's patented. And he's marketed this to Tennessee. It's in three states right now. It's now in Paulding County and in Fulton County. And I'd like for my entire remarks to go to the committee, if I could.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, Chuck Breedlove.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Jeff Breedlove. I'm a person in long-term recovery from substance use disorder or addiction, and I'm here today as a staff member from the Georgia Council for Recovery, a member of the Mental Health Policy Partnership and the Substance Use Disorder Policy Partnership. Those two organizations represent over 60 organizations active in your district across the state who have been working all this past year, working in public, in good faith with the Behavioral Health and Innovation Reform Commission. This bill before you is not a House bill. It's not a Senate bill. It's a bill that came out of the good work for a year in public meetings, in committees, broadcast on the internet, where thousands of Georgians have participated in the process to get us to where we are today. The bill needs perfection, of course. I used to work for the Senate. I know you will do your job and perfect this bill, absolutely, positively. But what cannot stand are some of the attacks on the very premise of this bill. I want to tell you about the why in about 1 minute. The why is because this bill, at the end of the day, is not about a fiscal note. It's not about some device. What this bill is about are people like me. There are people in this room today who have survived the disease that you're talking about. 30 seconds. This bill is designed to save lives and restore families. I survived the disease, but our families are significantly impacted economically. Please perfect the bill, but do not buy the lie that have been contained in the four emails that you've received. Thank you very much.
Next is Grant Minow.
Thank you, Senators, for ridding Georgia of TikTok and Chinese tracking.
Yes.
Mental Health Equity 1.0 HB 1013 was gutted by senators a year ago. Senators prudently removed numerous references to the World Health Organization's definition for mental health and stopped the possibility of TikTok-like Chinese biometric wristbands and components from being used in Georgia mental health care. Now Mental Health Equity 2.0 HB 520 unexplainably allows for TikTok-like tracking, but 10 times worse. Mental Health Parity 2.0 fails to provide any meaningful definitions, as you've heard here. What is mental health? What is mental illness? What is serious mental illness? What is monitoring? HB 520 cites these things numerous times. Who monitors? How do you monitor? Are these going to use Chinese components, pieces, and parts for monitoring? Who maintains the data? What if the company that's there sells their company? Then what happens to the data? Presumably, these questions will be left up to a few elite mental health czars. And if I'm wrong, then what would be the harm in banning any and all aspects related to China as it results to any and all monitoring of any kind relative to Mental Health Equity 2.0? There would be no harm, so why not do that? But the most important information is during last year's Senate hearings for HB 1013 was that Mental Health Equity was overturned on March 22, 2022 by the Federal Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, Witt versus United Behavioral Health. Had that been known by this body a year ago, Georgia Mental Health Equity would not have just been gutted, but it would have been halted. The very name of last year's bill, HB 1013, Mental Health Equity, was based on the notion that a federal mandate existed for mental health equity. There are ample arguments during last year's hearing based on a federal mandate which no longer exists. That was deliberately withheld from this body. I have supplied, and I believe somebody's going to pass out the open records that I obtained, to where the proponents and one of the bill's sponsors deliberately withheld that information during the Senate hearings last year. That is wrong. That should not have stopped. Please oppose HB 520. Table it. Don't let this legislation go any further. Thank you.
Next, Roland Boone.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak to you today. I come in here in strong support of HB 520. As you mentioned, my name is Roland Bain. I volunteer and serve as a board member with the Georgia chapter of the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. To clear up a misunderstanding, it is not a psychopharma organization. It's a volunteer organization that happens to provide the largest amount of private funding for suicide prevention research in the United States. So let's deal with the facts and move from there. I'm also the co-founder of the Georgia Mental Health Policy Partnership today. My remarks focus on three things. One, the studies and task forces under HB 520 are not an expansion of state government. Georgia is at the beginning of a journey to transform mental health and substance use care in the state. The studies and task forces will create the map for that journey. Absent a map, Georgia's journey will be aimless and costly, both in terms of individual health outcomes and taxpayer funds. The studies and task forces will provide transparency and accountability for the journey, and there is a need to ensure that behavioral health care in the state achieves the best results while ensuring that government is an effective steward of taxpayer funding. Second, data referenced in HB 520 are safeguarded by state and federal laws and regulations. Those safeguards are a function of the data itself and exist independent of the bill. unless required to ensure the health and safety of an individual, no data can be used to personally identify Georgia citizens. The DIF identified data currently exists and is being used by individual agencies. The bill enables the sharing of the DIF identified data to create the behavioral health care map that we need. Third, HB 520 does not expand Medicaid in Georgia. As you heard from Chairman Jones, nothing in HB 520 results in an increase in the number of Medicaid enrollees, nor does it require any additional funding by Georgia for its Medicaid programs. The bill provides most effective treatment options for Medicaid enrollees. Thank you.
Okay, next, Mallory Staples.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to address you all. I am representing both myself and the State Freedom Caucus Network. I have several arguments about HB 520, but the one that I'd like to highlight today is that this bill addresses mental health issues, yet does not mention the root cause. That is concerning. What is the root cause of the mental illness issues we're seeing? Prior to the pandemic, those numbers and the ones we have today, vastly different. Why? I'm innately opposed to a build it and they will come type of model. To create a bill this size, and I'd have to take issue with some of the other speakers, that does grow the government. To create this type of bill, this size, with this type of spending, with this type of growth, and about 18 other concerns, when you have not, as the bill gives testimony to, done the studies, defined the terms, and put your finger on the root cause. To the average citizen, that screams government. We don't want more government. The private sector has some amazing organizations, and I think a lot of them are represented in this room. I know Georgia Works. I know City of Refuge in the private sector that are addressing with compassion, with empathy, with efficiency and ingenuity, these groups that need help. Why would we not first, thank you, give the private sector the opportunity to do this, to do it well, to outperform government, which is historically the record? And why would we sideline that, not even have that be a discussion, and go down this path of growing in this way and burdening the taxpayers when we could build up the private sector? To the average citizen of moderate intelligence like myself, that doesn't make sense. And that's not what we're looking to you guys for. Please think outside of the box, and thank you for the time.
Okay, next we have Darlene Lynch.
Thank you, Chairwoman, and thank you, committee. I'm Darlene Lynch, and I'm here on behalf of the Center for Victims of Torture in Georgia, a longtime member of the Georgia Mental Health Policy Partnership, and one of the handful of providers in the state serving Georgia's refugee and immigrant communities today. I rise to share the enthusiastic support of my organization, as well as the Coalition of Refugee Service Agencies, which is some of those organizations mentioned earlier who are doing the good work here in Georgia of walking alongside our refugee and immigrant members. We believe that HB 520 is creating a modern, evidence-based system that serves all Georgians, including our foreign-born communities. Today, foreign-born Georgians make up 10% of the state's population and 14% of our workforce. About a 500,000 are still learning English. Takes a while to learn English. And yet there are so few providers that thousands of hardworking Georgians are effectively barred from access to care. DBHDD has acknowledged that in its grant applications that there is a critical unmet need here that actually threatens its risk, its federal funding. HB 520 is a critical step forward, and we particularly support the provisions in the bill in Section 12 that would modernize licensing. In Section 19, that would help attract clinicians to underserved communities like ours. And in Sections 3 and 19, that will stop our communities from being invisible and help it identify and address the gaps in cultural and linguistic competencies. We thank you for your attention and hope you'll support the bill.
Thank you. Next, Bill Quinn.
Good afternoon. So during the invocation, I believe I heard an invitation for hard questions. So let's have a couple. I heard Representative Jones speak to, there's so much in here that's in previous bills and has been there for many years. But isn't it your job to look at the law in place and amend or add to things that make sense for the time? That has to be part of your job, I believe. So he also talked about the two affidavit issue. Like most parts of the law, I believe, it's open to use, but unfortunately could be open to misuse. What do you say to the residents of Georgia when somebody were to misuse this, put their name on an affidavit because of a disagreement maybe with a neighbor, perhaps someone has a fight at school, and all of a sudden the parent gets a call, maybe they don't even get the call, and their child has been taken in for evaluation on the word of two people, and the names are now redacted. Yeah, we could take it to court perhaps. How long does that take? In the meantime, a child is being harmed, or another member of a family. These things are not about the way that they are stated in the bill, perhaps. Sometimes they're about looking for the holes in between that open the possibility of misuse. Why, for example, is virtually every provider, every firm, every association that will be associated with this bill given full immunity from both civil and criminal penalties? Why would they need criminal immunity? And again, it deals with acting on good faith. How do you tell that after the fact? I would ask the committee to carefully consider these things before doing any action that allows this bill to move forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, Virginia Hammond.
Madam Chair, of course I leave this to your discretion. There might be a couple of points that require some response, but I'll leave that to your discretion either today or later.
Hi, thank you for letting me speak.
Can you hold the mic a little closer so we can hear you? Thank you.
Sure, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
I'm here to say a few things on a more personal note. Part of this bill is to allow information to be passed from one entity to another to facilitate better care for patients. I'm here to speak about my own personal experience with antidepressants. I've been a long time sufferer of depression, and I changed jobs back in 2019. Had to change health insurance companies because I changed jobs, and when that happened, my new insurance company would not allow me to continue taking the antidepressant that I had been successfully taking for several years. They wanted me to stop taking it and go to a cheaper alternative. That sounds very reasonable on the surface, but the reality is it takes 4 to 6 weeks for an antidepressant to become effective. It also takes several months to come off of an antidepressant. So when you ask a patient that's dealing with depression to change their prescription, you're talking about several months worth of issues, problems, health problems. I missed work, and it was life affecting. So I don't think a lot of people know that that's the case, but I think it needs to be looked at. That it's difficult. You can't just stop one and start another. It's difficult.
Thank you very much. Barbara Bush.
My name is Barbara Bush. I'm here representing myself. I have, I'm a recovering drug addict for 40 years, continuous clean time. I've worked with the Department of Behavioral Health to write their grants and I've worked with Gwinnett County and other, also worked at SAMHSA as far as research treatment for detoxing pregnant women. I have gone through this bill and I have several concerns, some of which would be repetition as far as the definitions are concerned. The data sharing, I have a real concern with. One of the things I did when Gwinnett County was right, the criminal justice information system grant, so I had to learn all that engineering stuff. And I know that there is a way to share information. At the same time, I also am very aware of the fact that there is no such thing as real encryption, that there is, people can encrypt it, but there is many people who can unencrypt it as can encrypt it. So as far as information being secure, that's a real concern. One of the things I'm very concerned about is I still do some, I'm sort of semi-retired, and so I do some work with organizations as far as grants are concerned, particularly federal grants. So I get all of the information, and the federal government has now put pregnancy and reproductive health as part of behavioral health and has allowed abortion services to be readdressed under behavioral health. And with that, pregnancy was mentioned in the bill, but I don't know that people are thoroughly aware of the fact that this is a backdoor to abortion services, and the federal government claims preemption in their materials.
Thank you very much. Okay, this is going to be our last witness for today, Whitney Griggs. And as I mentioned at the beginning, because we have a hard stop at 3 o'clock, I'm sorry that we didn't get to hear from everybody, but I would encourage you to give us your written testimony. You can send it to me and I'll make sure that the rest of the committee gets it. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll be very brief. My name is Whitney Griggs. I'm the health policy analyst with Georgians for a Healthy Future. We are a member of the Mental Health Policy Partnership. We are very supportive of this bill and specifically the increase in coverage options for current Medicaid members and an increase in the services. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I apologize that we couldn't hear from everybody. It's that time of the session where we're extremely tied up and our rooms are short and our members have to run off to other committees. So thanks to everyone for coming down. Stay tuned. This is a long process. We're just the beginning of it. Thanks very much. We're adjourned.
I'm just having a good day.